Thank you so much for inviting me. It is an honor, a pleasure, and extremely meaningful. The problem is I feel like I have nothing to say. I feel like I have nothing to say because speaking after Eben Moglen is a very complicated task. And I feel like I have nothing to say because I'm here in Poland, which is probably one of the countries, or maybe the country in the European Union, that has done the most work on the issue already. So I'll try anyway to provide with some strategical input about the ongoing steps. You may know all of this already because as you've demonstrated along with the ACTA fight where we were so happy to have you around, that yes, you've done part of the work already. So I won't go into the tactical details, the very next steps, the objectives that we have directly inside, because they are quite obvious. The European Commission is now afraid of our ideas. The European Commission is afraid of who we are and what we demand. And for the last year, the European Commission has been trying to occupy the ground of a debate around copyright reform by this bullshit, oops, I cannot say bullshit, this is being live streamed. Well, you laid it out. With this bullshit initiative called Licenses for Europe. Like, oh sure, there are problems with copyright. We will fix everything with licenses, don't worry. So this thing is coming to an end. We'll expose some of the corruption going on inside of the process. And this will end by early November. This will be the moment to attack the European Commission and show its irrelevance at tackling the real issues. And this will be the moment to put forward our agenda, including, obviously, this necessary revision of the Directive 2001/29 Mr. Zalewski just mentioned. Also, the tactical objectives I will not mention is the European elections of 2014, where we must ensure that those questions are high in the public debate, and we must ensure that people in each and every political party who stand for ideas are in good position and get elected. Now, what I want to speak about is more what we learn about strategic perspectives around those issues, what we learn from the ACTA fight. Because for everybody it was something very much exhilarating, we were every day saturated with emails and tweets and phone calls and etc. But it is way time that we look at it from a distance and that we learn from what happens, and that we, learning from that, we can see what maybe is replicable, what we can reuse for the future, and use this to prolongate this momentum, to prolongate this energy, and to achieve longer objectives. First of all that happened on ACTA was based on analysis. We spent 4 years as La Quadrature du Net doing analysis of leaked drafts, first leaked on WikiLeaks in 2008, then some drafts that we leaked ourselves. And this analysis was what made us credible, what enabled us to go to members of the parliament, to the press, to other organizations, and show them concretely those words, cooperative measures, those criminal sanctions for aiding and abetting, and so on, are the evidence of what we're claiming. So this hard analytical work has to be done, and has to be done on, well, on the opposition side when we speak of ACTA, but also on the propositional side. This is why the work of the Modern Poland Foundation is so essential at providing concrete proposals, concrete measures. We've been doing something quite similar with La Quadrature du Net, and I encourage you to look at our 14 elements for the reform of copyright and associated cultural policy. This is essential work, and I encourage all of you to come and participate in those debates, in comment, whatever is commentable, and do this in the open, which our opponents don't. Also, we must have in mind a perpetual and evolving analysis of the threats. And among the threats today is our increasing dependency on massively centralized services such as Google. It is a threat for a cultural practice. It is a threat for a culture that Hollywood and its affiliates are one push of a button to censor whatever content they want online. It is a major problem. You may remember a video we produced called Robo Copyright ACTA. It was a remix, it was obviously a parody taken from the movie RoboCop by Paul Verhoeven in 1987, in which we featured, you may remember, this big robot with two machine guns called ED-209. We figured it as ACTA. The stupid robot was applying automatic copyright and killed someone in the movie. Well, all robo-copyright just got censored by the robo-copyright of Google. Content ID, it is called. Oh, we're sorry, your video was taken down because it may contain copyrighted material by the MGM. It may contain copyrighted material. So this centralization of privatized censorship is one of the major threats to the expression of a culture and to a cultural practices today. And we must address this. We thought for some time that Google was our ally on this, but we were also wrong. They jumped in the bed of Hollywood and never left it. So from analysis, the second step of our strategy is building alliances. This is something crucial. This is how we won on ACTA, because we had farmers, we had HIV patients, because we had vintage video gamers, because we had academics, because we had people from the left, the right, the center, the blue, the red, the yellow, the whatever. Because we managed to build this alliance beforehand. This is how we filled the streets, this is how we filled the blogs and the tweets and so on. So we must reach for those communities as of today. I am convinced that the turning point in our momentum will be when authors and artists will feel free to emancipate from the tremendous pressure that collecting societies put on themselves, so they cannot express themselves freely on those questions. And also it is natural for artists, you know, artists just art. They do not want to be involved into politics. And whenever they receive, as an example for France, 10 requests from their collective society to sign a petition supporting a legislative project by the government, well, maybe they just do it in the end. So trying to go today for the artists must be something a bit risky, but they will come, like everybody else. But I think they will come in the end. Until then, we must identify those key communities, whether professional or cultural communities that could join us. Maybe journalists, maybe academics and scientists who see every day how the abuses of copyright is banning them from sharing the academic knowledge that they know should be free. So we should go patiently, talk to these people, maybe the trade unions, maybe the street artists, maybe live performers or whatever. And this is an essential job. The same way we should go and speak to people in each and every political party. And I can tell you out of experience, the most gratifying examples, the most rewarding conversations you can have is when you convince somebody who is the further away from your own political view. This is how you realize that you're right, that your thoughts are universal, and that you're actually getting somewhere. So we must do this in a transpartisan way. This is the only way. Finally, the messages that we're convening. They must be broadened, and they must be broadened to reflect the crucial nature of our struggle. It is crucial for the future of our societies. Will we be free human beings able to express ourselves, whether it's politically, or creatively, culturally, in the future? Will we be free? This is what it is about, and then say it in way better terms than I can ever put it myself. So the debate today is about enforcing our cultural rights. Nothing less. It is written in Article 27 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Every citizen has the right to participate in the cultural life of the community. This is what we stand for. Of course, we are in the forefront. We are a generation that is either born with the internet or that saw the internet boom and embraced it. So we know in our hearts, in our minds, that sharing and remixing are part of a culture. We know because we grew up with techno and hip hop and maybe Baile Funk or Kuduro or whatever. And we know that the musics of today are based on sharing and remixing and nothing else. So this is what we should claim to the world. We stand for cultural right to share and to remix. And in the end, because our message influences our modes of action, we must always keep in mind that this is a diversity that is key to our victories. This is the diversity of the modes of actions. This is by making videos and images and songs and blogs and books and poems and everything that we will win. And another final and maybe the most important lesson we learned in ACTA is that while doing it, we must keep having fun. I thank you very much.